the thumbs up from the camera. Meeting will come to order. If you join me in a moment of silent prayer or reflection.
Nicole Cohen?
Here.
Martina Aliar?
Here.
John Mastin? Kathy Cox?
Here.
Lisa Roman?
Here. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We have suspended the call to the public, but if you have any comments or concerns, you can always email them to boardmeeting@lhusd.org, and we will make time to get to those. At this time, we're going to do a recognition of visitors, and our first item on the agenda is to discuss COVID-19 and get an update from our current superintendent and our soon-to-be superintendent. And I would like to remind people that this is just discussion. Nothing related to COVID is on the agenda today, so we will not be voting. We are just going to be hearing about the strategies that have been discussed and possibly offer our own input. So without anything further.
Well, thank you. I just wanted to let the board know that throughout this process, we've been having regular meetings at the county level. Our county superintendent has been hosting meetings with the various superintendents. Actually, weekly, we've had a meeting. And we also have, as needed, invited our county health department director to those. So there's an ongoing conversation. And as a county, Mojave County superintendents are discussing all of the varied ideas and options that we have coming out, as well as the information that we're getting from the state. The one area of focus that has been important is that the state appears to be, and the health department had affirmed that, because of the way that COVID has exhibited itself throughout our state, that these will be local decisions when we make these decisions about school. And so I wanted to share some data that that I found interesting, because when we hear about the prevalence of COVID-19, the three major areas that we have in our county is Bullhead City, Kingman, and Lake Havasu. And currently, Bullhead City has 234 cases, Kingman has 259, and Havasu has 117. So that was as of yesterday evening. In looking at the percent of population, and so if you think about those numbers, for Bullhead City, that is 0.5%. And for Kingman, it's 0.9%. So they're almost to 1%. And for Lake Havasu City, we are at 0.2% of our population. And so when you think about the overall population, the prevalence in our city is not as severe as it is in many other cases. And so when we're talking about our considerations, that is one of the considerations that we keep in mind. And so I'm actually just giving you those numbers and going to turn it over to Dr. Stone to do her update.
Madam President, members of the board, thank you for allowing me to talk a little bit tonight about what we've been doing in terms of working through reopening schools. As Diana mentioned, we have received a lot of guidance over the past few months from a variety of sources. The governor's office, the Arizona Department of Education, and Mojave County Health Department, and we talked about all of the county superintendents also meeting regularly to talk through these things. We are focused on keeping our staff, students, and families healthy while reopening schools on time August 3rd. We're looking forward to having our students back in the classroom. We believe that provides them with the most effective and best educational opportunities. While we would like to see things completely back to normal by August 3rd, it would be irresponsible for us not to consider other options that may be required as we continue to follow any state and local requirements. We're committed to serving all of our students, and we are aware that some families may want their children to stay home at this time, so there will be options available for those students as well, kind of as we move forward in talking about this. So as I talk about this, it is important to note again that there are no decisions that have been made. We will be bringing recommendations to the board for final approval before we do anything else. What you're seeing right now, a task force was created to look at a variety of scenarios for the upcoming school year. The task force included district office staff, all principals and assistant principals, our teachers, our nurses, district and school level, support staff as well. The task force was broken into two working groups. One group focused on instruction, and that was led by Jamie and Brad. They facilitated several meetings with an entire group to talk about what are the instructional options that we have available and how would that look moving forward. The other working group focused on daily operations, and that was run by Mike and Aggie, and they really looked at all of those things that go into the daily operation of schools, getting kids to school, feeding kids, cleaning and sanitizing. All of those things were taken into consideration. They looked at three scenarios: opening on time with restrictions for the limits of students and teachers that could be in one area, social distancing requirements, and they also looked at the scenario of school buildings being closed but continuing with instruction. Important to note that school buildings being closed and continuing with instruction is really something that would come much like we had the closure in the fourth quarter. It would come from the governor's office that closed us completely. So opening on time with no restrictions, which is certainly our option of choice, includes precautions to keep all staff, students, and families healthy by promoting behaviors that reduce the spread. This includes keeping students and staff who are sick at home. This will be a big campaign for us as we move forward, really wanting to partner with our families so they are making sure that they are checking their students before they come to school, with a list of symptoms, and making sure they keep them at home if they are sick. We will also be looking at hand hygiene and respiratory etiquette. Hand hygiene, washing your hands for 20 seconds, using soap and water, or the hand sanitizer that we do have, which meets all the requirements for making sure everyone has clean hands. Respiratory etiquette is really that covering your mouth when you cough or sneeze. Preferably what they're coming back with now is preferably with a tissue that you can then throw away once that's complete. Physical distancing really refers to remaining as far apart as you can. So when we talk about social distancing, and we have for quite some time, we hear the term 6 feet all the time. In our webinars and the things that we're starting to come out with guidance, it's really physical distancing as far apart as we can possibly manage in our classrooms. And also looking at some of those other options, like making sure our students are facing forward and not necessarily facing each other. We know we do a lot of group work in school, and we know that's important, but maybe looking at some other options there while we continue to address stopping the spread of the virus at this time. Cleaning our high-touch surfaces. Our staff is doing a great job of following all the guidelines. Cleaning surfaces is necessary, but want to assure everyone that we are continuing that protocol of cleaning high-touch surfaces each day. And then also offering options, additional options for students who do remain home at this time. And those are additional instructional options. The second scenario was opening on time with restrictions. Really, all of those things that were in place prior carry over into this scenario. But this really limits the number of students that we may be able to have in one classroom. So looking at altering student schedules if needed, and again, we haven't landed on a specific recommendation at this time, but there are all kinds of options that go with that. Kids attending morning and kids attending afternoon, kids attending on different days. And in the meantime, they would have work at home to finish. Traffic flow, looking at how kids walk in the hallways, maybe some one-way hallways, or just making sure that they are divided and kids are clearly following those physical distancing guidelines as they go. Looking at our commons areas where kids gather, the lunchrooms, our PE classes, the playgrounds, and then also offering those alternative options for instruction face-to-face, online, and a hybrid model of instruction. When we talk about online, it's really kids being provided with materials that they can access via email or whatever system that they're using, and then also submitting their work back to the teacher that way. Our final scenario was the school buildings being closed, and this is not something that we are hoping that happens at all, but if it were to happen, it would be very similar to the fourth quarter with online and our packet options for all of our students. The real difference here is that the material will no longer be review as it was during the fourth quarter. This would be trying to provide new instruction to students and move them forward in the curriculum. Our next steps in this process, the task force has worked very hard and provided some very thoughtful considerations for each of the scenarios presented. But that being said, we still need to hear from our parents and all of our staff in order to finalize our plans and make recommendations to the board for approval. The parent and staff surveys were sent out today and they will close on Sunday. They're fairly quick to fill out, and we will be using those results to inform our finalized plan. And we hope everyone takes a few minutes to fill that out. That's really important to us. We do plan to present the finalized plan to the board for approval at the July 6th meeting. And as I shared at the beginning, we are focusing on keeping all of our staff, students, and families healthy and really looking forward to returning on August 3rd. The one issue I probably didn't address in this and do want to share is really the use of personal protective equipment. There have been comments and people wondering, like, what is the plan? Really, as we listen to the webinars through ADE and through those other sources, they're focusing more on those guidelines, those universal guidelines that help slow the spread, which is really the washing your hands, staying home if you're sick. I'm missing two of them. Your respiratory etiquette, covering your sneeze and cough if you have that. And for those, we will not at this time be recommending that we require cloth masks for anyone, but certainly it would be an option for any staff member or student who felt the need to wear that during the day. And this time, I'm happy to see questions.
My question is, if we have to do the online learning, will it be Zoom or are we going to use Google Classroom?
At this time, the conversation is certainly around Google Classroom. Is that something that the kids already have an account for, at least 4 through 12? So that is something that we will be working with our teachers to really provide some professional development that works with them providing actual instruction through that, as opposed to just sharing information back and forth. It really is a platform that can provide new instruction moving forward.
Gina, can you hear? Does the sound okay?
I think so.
Thank you. That's also my main question.
One thing I was thinking about was lunch, and I was wondering, because we're offering right now, we're doing grab-and-go style meals for students, but I was wondering if that might be an option when the school year resumes, depending on what the circumstances are, to have them, instead of having them crowded into a cafeteria, if there's a way to maybe space them out with a grab-and-go somewhere else type of meal.
So I will tell you, our food services staff are working overtime to kind of provide different options for how this would look in each of our schools. And if you have additional information, please feel free to share.
They just submitted an email, sent us an email just literally, I think it was yesterday. Very comprehensive. They're actually on the phone right now in preparation for the items, the first three action items tonight. But I don't know if Ann wants to Actually, I don't think at this point we need to go into the details of that because we really haven't even had a chance as directors to digest it at this point. But know that Ann and Chris are working tirelessly in sharing those ideas and thoughts with us.
Has there been any consideration of taking absolutely no precautions other than what we have done in the past, washing hands and staying home when you're sick and not making any alterations at all? Has there been any talk of that? And if not, should we wait for the surveys before we're actually making plans from the parents and the staff? Because it seems to me while our schools were shut down, the kids were still getting together and playing, more so in their neighborhoods. They were at the parks, you know, they were out and about. You know, there's been a lot of congregating that has taken place, and I don't know that we've suffered in our 0 to 17 population because of it. I understand that adults might be more leery of working with a bunch of kids that are, you know, on top of each other, but it seems wrong to have these discussions at all, because as we so often hear, that this is the comforting place where our kids come to, and now all of a sudden we are going to completely turn their world upside down and normalize all these strange things, like we're not going to touch, we're not going to nurture, we're not going to do those kinds of things that I've heard that happen in our schools every day. So I just wonder if that's talked about at all.
We haven't talked about no precautions. We have certainly talked about all these universal precautions that you shared. If you're sick, remain home, hand washing, you know, covering your mouth and nose. The physical distancing piece is probably the newest piece. More cleaning protocols that perhaps we've had in the past. And really the other option as far as opening on time is if there are families. We do want to serve all of our students. So if there are families that tell us through that survey process, you're not comfortable coming back, it's really that conversation of, okay, so what can we provide you while you're at home?
Okay. And the other thing too is right now we cannot predict in August what's going to happen. So
sure.
And I'm sure you would agree that just being prepared for whatever that might be, and then what's going to happen in September. I mean, we might have to switch 180 degrees to 2 months into the school year. We just don't know. So having a plan, I think, is a good thing.
Sure. I just wondered if it had been discussed.
Okay.
And the precautions that are common sense have always been. So those aren't new. Washing hands and, you know, always on the list is Clorox wipes and those kinds of things. So I just wondered. And then my second question is, and I don't need any detail, but I would like for there to be a discussion about if we have another lockdown, I want to make sure that we don't have school staff, teacher showing up at parents' doors without them knowing, because I had a phone call on that and it was very concerning that there was no appointment made. And so I want to make sure that that's discussed. I think that's inappropriate. This isn't something the parents are asking for or the students. And I know that teachers, you know, think of students as their children, but to show up at somebody's home, that's a concern for me. So I'll leave it there, but I hope that'll be discussed too.
I am curious, and I don't want to ask you for details that you're not willing to provide, but was it like a congratulatory type of visit or like a wellness check kind of thing?
No, it was before that.
Okay.
It was a matter of the parent didn't return the call quick enough, and that's a concern for me.
Okay.
Because there's been a big overreach from government from this whole COVID-19, and, you know, it's kind of been normalized. We're sitting here talking about it like it's, you know, just another school year plan, but it really is, you know, a big overreach and a reaching into our lives, you know, affecting everybody's home life. So anyways, that's it. Lots of planning. I understand it's not easy. I'm not trying to minimize all the efforts that everybody's made. Just those are the things that were on my mind.
I do want to make sure I understood correctly. So if school kind of opens as scheduled, there will be an online option for the parents of children who would rather not send them to school. And will they have the option of maybe doing that for part of the time and then maybe sending them to school midway through the year if things settle down? Or do you have any details about that?
Not specific details, but yes, certainly we would like to welcome everybody back to school. Even if they start out in an online option and then decide that they're comfortable coming back, we would love to welcome them back.
I do have some positive feedback on the online option. My oldest child was able to do an online summer school class, and it has worked really well. He likes the pace of it, and the materials are very clear. So I just want to say that I do like that at least as an option, and I think it works particularly well with older kids. So, did anyone else have anything that they wanted to say?
Has there been any discussion about testing? I know that there's a push to test in schools, so is that being discussed?
In terms of end of the year testing or?
Oh, I'm sorry, COVID testing. Antibody testing type testing.
That has actually not been discussed for our task force.
Okay. But.
And so if I may address that one, in our county meeting that was on Monday, the question was asked because there are some county districts that are talking about requiring that all staff are tested or that students are tested. And the county health department does not support that, nor do they recommend it. They basically have said that testing should really focus on symptomatic individuals or those who are in close contact with positive cases. That it's a waste of resources. And on any given day, a person could be exposed and the next day they're positive. And so it's better to keep those for people who are symptomatic to ensure that they in fact are positive for COVID.
Okay.
And so that that was an interesting discussion. And again, that came from the health department.
Okay, I appreciate that because I've been reading about that around the country, not here, but around the country, that that's kind of a push and gonna be a requirement in a lot of areas. And my concern is that I'm also reading about how you don't own your blood anymore. So when your blood is taken now, it's no longer your property and they can do with it what, you know, they wish to. So, you know, me and my data, so it's a concern for me. Thank you.
I did want to say one more thing in support of masks. I do feel like they are still recommended widely. They are recommended by our state superintendent. And I don't know if I'm willing to go so far as to say that we should require them, except for people who need a reasonable accommodation to not wear them. But I do think that it might be wise to at least encourage them. That's my two cents on that.
For children?
Yes. And I do realize, I do sympathize because I think especially with the younger kids that that's going to be a hassle for the teachers, that a big part of their learning at the beginning of the year is just how to properly behave with a mask. And I don't want to be insensitive to that because I know it's going to be a hassle. But we do, if I'm looking at some of the populations that are seeing the spikes in cases, it tends to be in settings where people are shoulder to shoulder in an indoor situation. And that's very similar to a school classroom. I just would hate to leave an option on the table that could reduce the risk for students. And especially, I understand that the 0 to 19 cohort is not particularly at risk for contracting the virus, but that doesn't mean that they can't be a vector for the virus and take it home to parents or be a part of spreading it throughout the community. It's one of the reasons, I'm a healthy person. I don't deserve to be healthy, I just am because I'm relatively young and I'm lucky. I wear a mask because it helps me to not be a potential vector to other people. Anyone else?
I have a comment about this topic. So this is from Marcia Cox. As LHUSD begins to plan for the reopening of our school, I want to remind the board that the guidelines given to us by CDC and others within our state are merely guidelines and not mandatory. I've been reminded by many of my physician clients that they practice medicine and it is a science. Theories evolve, ideas change, some result into miracle treatments like aspirins, and other into disasters like thalidomide, a drug destined for greatness as a non-barbiturate sedative, and then came flipper babies. My point is that there is so much controversy, including information from OSHA and many thousands of practicing physicians, not researching physicians, that masks could be harmful. Do we want these harmful effects to be at the expense of our kids' mental and physical health? I sure hope not. Recently, a friend of mine told me her experience of trying to convince her 8-year-old daughter to wear a mask on a 3-hour plane ride. The thought of keeping her mask on for the child was so traumatic, the child started to hyperventilate. And this was a cute mask made just for kids. The child already has anxiety issues. Imagine what was going to happen when she finds out she needs to wear a mask every day at school. There is a better way. The recommendations are not mandatory, and clearer heads must prevail. Not every researcher has been right on guessing, dare I say, practicing on the American public with what we should or shouldn't do to protect ourselves. I choose and hope our board, parents, and public will choose logic boosting our immune system, the one we were born with, and not an artificial means of protecting us from an invisible virus that no one can be sure a cotton or cloth mask can assure prevention. I ask that our school board and members of our school district that are part of the Vision Task Force put together by Superintendent Hoffman consider the long-term unknowns, just like we tragically learned with thalidomide. Sincerely, Marcia Cox.
Thank you, Mrs. Cox. No more emails.
There's one more. This is from Juliana Gilhey, G-I-L-G-J-E. Hello, I know you are getting many questions regarding schools opening up in August. We just withdrew our son from Telesis to attend LHHS as a freshman. With everything going on with the virus, we are recently looking for an online school for his and our family's safety. We take the virus very seriously. With 2,000 students at LHHS and oversized classes, we don't see how social distancing will be possible. And while we know your final answer on schools opening, I hope there will be an online option for schools attending LHHS for the current time so we don't have to withdraw him to an online school. He's an honor student and his English teacher has an assignment for them to read over the summer. I haven't had him start reading the assignment yet because I don't know where he will be attending. We hope to hear a final decision soon.
So hopefully she kind of got her answer or her question answered throughout the course that online will be an option for students regardless of what our reopening looks like.
Okay. I do think it would be important to clarify. And when we talk about online school, and if a parent is enrolled in an online school that is not the LHUSD online school, they cannot enroll in LHUSD because they are actually, that school is getting paid for that student. And so in thinking about a blended program, if we had students that came maybe just, you know, once a week and saw a teacher and had online assignments, they would need to be in our online school for that to work. And the reason that I bring that up is from that, it sounds like this parent is involved in a different online school. So if they're holding off on starting the work because of enrollment at LHUSD, our online program would be different from that, if that makes sense.
And I would encourage that person to reach out with her specific concerns to the high school office and still be able to answer her. Anything more on COVID? Do we have anything from the LHCEA?
I do. My computer just froze. From Carol Nowakowski, I wanted to share that I've appreciated that you've kept the opportunity for LHCEA to speak monthly under recognition of visitors. As we continue to watch CDC, Arizona Health Department, and Mojave County's Health Department guidelines, we want you to know that we're still planning a date in the future to host a meet and greet for staff and Dr. Stone. As soon as the health department supports an opportunity, we hope to make it happen. Sincerely, Carol Nowakowski.
We'll go ahead and move on to our consent agenda. Do I have a motion to approve item 4.1?
So moved.
Seconded.
Any commentary?
I like consent.
Archana Aliar?
Yes.
Joel Cohen?
No.
John Mastin, sorry. Kathy Cox?
Yes.
Lisa Roman?
Yes. Moving on, no old business, so we're moving on to item 6.1. This is the renewal of Tahoe Food Service contract for 2020-2021, and it's presented by Mr. Murray.
Madam President, members of the board, it is recommended the governing board approve the renewal of the contract with Tahoe Food Service for the fiscal year 2020-2021. In 2019, the district approved a 5-year contract with Tahoe with 4 annual renewals. This contract can be mutually canceled or renewed by the parties. If this action item is approved, it would be the first renewal of the contract. The renewal document has been submitted to the Arizona Department of Education and has been approved, and a copy is attached for the board's review. The Tahoe, I have on the phone Ann Tafe, food service supervisor with the district, and Chris Gallaga, who is with Tahoe. They're on the phone to answer any questions for this action.
Well, hello, Mrs. Tafe. Does anyone have it? Oh, I'm sorry, do I have a motion on 6.1?
I move that we approve 6.1 as presented.
Second.
Any discussion about this item? More questions for Mrs. Page?
Is Ann on the line?
She is.
On his cell phone.
Oh. So I'm just wondering from last year if you've watched the Magic Pill yet.
She can
hear you. Yeah,
can you hear
her? That's okay. Yeah.
No, I didn't.
She said no, I didn't. Also, she heard me.
So you did hear her.
I heard something, but I did not hear the question.
It's Nicole. I'm sorry. I asked if you had a chance to watch The Magic Pill yet.
Okay, I still, there's still some distance between your phone and...
Yeah, you can relay.
I'm not sure who's speaking or can hear the question.
I'll have to repeat it, Mike.
She asked if you watched The Magic Pill yet.
Oh, no, I haven't. Next time I see her, I will have watched it.
Okay. Anything else? We're ready to vote.
Nicole Cohen?
Yes.
Kathy Cox?
Yes.
Archana Aliar?
Yes.
Lisa Roman?
Yes. Item 6.2 is the approval to increase school meal prices, and this is presented by Mr. Murray.
Madam President, members of the board, it is recommended the governing board approve an increase of 10 cents to school lunch prices for the fiscal year 21 school year. There will be no increase to the school breakfast pricing. The governing board is asked to approve an increase to school lunch prices to become effective for the 21 school year. USD requires that there is an equity in school lunch pricing, a provision that requires school districts to charge students for paid meals at a price that is on average equal to the difference between free meal reimbursement and the paid meal reimbursement. Schools that currently charge less for meal prices than the amount needed to create paid lunch equity are required to gradually increase prices over time until they meet the requirement or supplement their food service operating funds with non-federal funds to ensure equity. The prices for breakfast and lunch during the fiscal year 20 school year are also as follows down below. You can see that, and then also the proposed 10 cents addition to the lunch prices for school year 21 is also listed below.
Any questions or comments? Do I have a motion on item 6.2?
I move we approve 6.2 as presented.
I second.
Any discussion?
Kathy Cox?
Yes.
Arjan Alyar?
Yes.
Nicole Cohen?
Yes.
Lisa Roman?
Yes. Item 6.3, the approval of food program permanent service agreement. And this is presented by Mr. Murray and Mrs. Page.
Madam President, members of the board, it is recommended the governing board approve the food program permanent service agreement to come into compliance with operating the seamless summer option or summer food service program during the unanticipated closure due to COVID-19. As per the attached memo, the Arizona Department of Ed released a single FPPSA for school food authorities to include the National School Lunch Program, School Breakfast Program, Special Milk Program, and At-Risk After School Meals component of Child and Adult Care Food Programs. The previous version of the FPPSA does not cover participation in the SFSP and SSO. The separate versions were last approved in July of 2014.
Do I have a motion on item 6.3?
I move to approve item 6.3 as read.
Second.
Any discussion or questions? So I was a little bit unclear on how this differs from what we normally offer. Is this kind of the grab and go component that we're talking about, or is it like a little bit of additional food?
Yeah, did you hear that?
Yes, I did. We have always been operating the seamless summer option of the summer food service program, and the state and USDA has always had a separate agreement for that program and for the National School Lunch Program, and they are basically just streamlining things into one agreement. And this actually will come again before the board in another month or two when we have to take off Mrs. Osire's name and put on Dr. Stone's name. So it is a formality with ADE.
Okay. Any other questions or discussion?
Arjan Alyar?
Yes.
Nicole Cohen?
Yes.
Kathy Cox?
Yes.
Lisa Roman?
Yes. Item 6.4 is the approval to purchase computers for the Lake Havasu High School Music and Audio Lab. And this was submitted by Mrs. Becker and Mrs. Vestavagel.
Madam President and Governing Board, it is recommended that the board approve the request to purchase computers for the Lake Havasu High School Music and Audio Lab, paid for by the Western Arizona Vocational Education District, WAVE CTED, not to exceed $57,000. The Lake Havasu Unified School District CTE department is requesting the purchase of 31 new computers, not to exceed $57,000, through WAVE CTED grants and funding. The funds will be used to upgrade the music and audio lab with new computers. Currently, the music and audio classes computers are not compatible. Are not able to keep up with technology used for students to create videos and comply with current standards of class. The computers have been upgraded to the highest capacity and are now needing to be replaced. Our music and audio class offers Pro Tools and Adobe industry certifications for students, and our hardware must be able to keep up with current technology. The current computers are between 7 and 9 years old. This item has been reviewed by purchasing.
Do I have a motion on item 6.4?
I move to approve item 6.4.
I second.
Any discussion?
I have a question. I know these computers are old, but are you going to be able to repurpose them?
Yeah, they'll be repurposed to other labs. They're just not able to use the software that they're needed in that classroom.
Okay, labs. Mm-hmm. Other labs.
Anything else?
Nicole Cohen?
Yes.
Kathy Cox?
Yes.
Regina Allier?
Yes.
Lisa Roman?
Yes. Item 6.5 is the approval of expansion of the classical education program to grades 7 and 8, and it's presented by Mrs. Assayer.
Thank you. Madam President, members of the board, it is recommended that the governing board approve the expansion of the classical education program in English language arts to grades 7 and 8. Earl Grande Classical Academy has opened with an amazing success in its first year. The option of a classical curriculum has proven appealing to our community and has garnered state and national attention. In the initial conversations regarding the magnet school opportunity, the board requested consideration of a pathway for the academy students that would continue beyond the sixth grade. The logical curriculum to continue is the Hillsdale College Scope and Sequence for English Language Arts, which is the core knowledge curriculum. Thunderbolt Middle School would offer classical English for all incoming Oro Grande Classical Academy students for grades 7 and 8. In this initial phase, four sections would be offered while the curriculum is piloted. Students will be placed in the additional sections according to their team placement. After the first year, parents who requested classical English for their students will have the opportunity for the remaining seats. Should requests exceed the available seats, additional sections may be added in the future. As students progress through the classical academy, expansion of additional subjects may be considered to create a full pathway.
Do I have a motion on item 6.5?
I move that we approve 6.5 as presented.
I second.
Any discussion or questions?
What kind of training will the teachers get who are going to be teaching in middle school?
So the teacher who will be teaching the seventh grade this year and who taught the eighth grade last year went through the original training with Oro Grande, and that individual will be training the person who's going to be teaching what he taught the previous year. So he's actually taught it a year and we'll do that entry.
Anything else? Okay, can I have a motion on item 6.5?
As a comment. This is from Wendy Moore. Dear President Roman, Superintendent Assayer, and board members, I would like to express my gratitude for beginning the Classical Academy at Oro Grande and also encourage you to continue to expand this education to our junior high and high school. This education is highly sought out in our country, and I think we have something special in our city that should continue to grow. Our students will be able to take advantage of the opportunity that this curriculum gives them as they progress through the grades, and it will round out their education wonderfully. Please consider expanding the classical education to all grades and help our students understand how much you value them. Thank you for your time, and I hope to see you all again soon. All my best, Wendy Moore.
One point of clarification, I don't think this program is available beyond eighth grade. Did I misunderstand that?
The Hillsdale Scope and Sequence goes through grade 12. The core knowledge is through the eighth grade. And then they actually have a book list and writing, basically curriculum that they use and recommend for the 9th through 12th.
I just wanted to mention that this program is so awesome and unique, and I really want to just look into the camera for anybody who's watching, because where we were special, and we are the only public school in the whole country who's been gifted this scope and sequence from Hillsdale College, as a result of the COVID, they have doubled down and they have made everything go live on their website. So they are providing opportunities for homeschoolers. The amount of free education, when I say free, I mean there's no credit card required, is astounding. So I'd invite anybody watching to go onto the Hillsdale website and look and see what is there for the parents as well, for our high schoolers, for anybody who's looking to educate themselves. So we were very unique, but they have now heard the urgent call, I think, to educate as many people as possible. And so I fear we won't be unique shortly, because all the information that we had is now going to be made available to anybody who wants it, so, which is a wonderful thing. So, but anyways, that was it.
Thank you. Any other discussion?
Kathy Cox?
Yes.
Archana Alyar?
Yes.
Nicole Cohen?
Enthusiastically, yes.
Lisa Roman?
Yes. Item 6.6 is the appointment of an employee benefit trustee, and this is presented by Mr. Murray.
Madam President, members of the board, it is recommended the governing board approve the appointment of Ms. Stephanie Luares to the Employee Benefit Trust Board of Trustees effective July 1st, 2020. ARS 15-382C specifies, trustees are appointed by the governing board, and if any employee of the school district is acting as a trustee, the trust shall be administered by at least 5 joint trustees, of whom no more than one may be an employee of the school district. Mrs. Luares was the only applicant to apply for the 2 open positions, an employee benefit trust board of trustee term. Terms are 3 years, therefore the trust membership would be, if approved, as follows below. We can see that Ms. Luares' term would expire on June 30th of 2023.
Do I have a motion on?
She is on the phone. Sorry about that.
Okay.
Just in case.
Very good. Do I have a motion on item 6.6?
I make a motion that we approve Stephanie Luares for the Employee Benefit Trust Board as presented.
I second.
Any discussion or questions for Mrs. Luares? I didn't have any questions either. I looked over her application and I feel that she is very qualified for the spot. I asked about the vacancy because right now it is just a 4-member out of 5-member board. And it's my understanding that if someone wants to apply in a sort of midstream, that that is an option. Is that correct?
That is correct. And we will continue to look to fill that vacancy. I believe, I know there's an upcoming meeting in October. So we will definitely try to have someone seated before then, or at least presented to the board to have consider their appointment.
Well, and then, I want to say thank you to Mrs. Luares for applying for this position and for her interest in serving the community. Is there any further discussion?
Archana Alyar?
Yes.
Nicole Cohen?
Yes.
Kathy Cox?
Yes.
Lisa Roman?
Yes. Item 6.7 is the approval of creation of supervisor evaluation and revision of teacher on assignment and interventionist evaluations. And this is presented by Mrs. Bessa Daigle.
Madam President and Governing Board, it is recommended that the Governing Board approve evaluations for the following categories of employees: supervisors, interventionists, and teachers on assignment. Currently, supervisors are evaluated using the same tools as the staff they supervise. The tool is not specific to the important leadership role they play within LHUSD. An evaluation that is specific to each of the supervisors' positions has been developed. The teacher on assignment and intervention evaluations were last revised in 2013 and do not align to the new LHUSD teacher evaluation system and other district initiatives. TOAs and interventionists have not consistently had self-evaluations of professional goals as part of the evaluation process as other teachers have. The update will bring these evaluations into alignment with other teacher evaluations and be broad enough that they are not tied to a specific program, so the evaluation can be used across the district. These evaluations have been developed with other leaders at all levels and will be implemented in the 2021 school year. They represent challenging yet reasonable expectations for staff and opportunities for staff to grow throughout their careers. A copy of each evaluation document was electronically provided to the governing board prior to this meeting.
Do I have a motion on item 6.7?
I move to approve item 6.7.
I second.
Any discussion?
I have a question. Are these teachers eligible for 301, these positions?
Mm-hmm.
And they've been getting 301?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, a supervisor is a classified position, but teachers on assignment and interventionists are certified teachers.
This is just a way of streamlining everything so you don't have 2 different systems.
Okay.
Any other discussion?
Nicole Cohen?
Yes.
Kathy Cox?
Yes.
Marchand Avia?
Yes.
Lisa Roman?
Yes. Item 6.8 is the approval of resolutions for fiscal year 2020-2021, and it's presented by Mr. Murray.
Madam President, members of the board, it is recommended the governing board approve resolutions number 2020-21-01 through 2020-21-10. The action described in the recommendation is necessary to continue our current practices through the 2021 fiscal year. The resolutions as submitted are maintenance resolutions and would not affect any substantial change in our current operating procedures.
Do I have a motion on item 6.8?
I move we approve 6.8 as presented.
I second.
Any discussion or questions from Mr. Murray?
Housekeeping, annual for anybody who's curious.
Are there any discussions?
Kathy Cox?
Yes.
Marchand Avia?
Yes.
Nicole Cohen?
Yes.
Lisa Roman?
Yes. Item 6.9 is the approval of resolution and borrowing request to Wells Fargo Bank, and it's presented by Mr. Murray.
Madam President, members of the board, it is recommended the governing board approve and sign a borrowing request to be forwarded to the Mojave County Treasurer, along with a resolution authorizing the request. The Mojave County Treasurer has requested the governing board approve and sign a borrowing request to Wells Fargo Bank for a credit line in the amount of $1 million. It is not anticipated the district will be required to borrow funds from Wells Fargo. However, this paperwork must be in place in case that becomes a necessity. Also attached is a resolution of the board authorizing the borrowing request, and legal counsel has reviewed both documents.
Do I have a motion on item 6.9?
Move we approve 6.9 as presented.
I second.
Any discussion?
Have we borrowed on this since you've been in this position?
No, not at all.
So it's just a backup, it's just in case.
That's correct.
Anyone else?
Marchand Avia?
Yes.
Nicole Cohen?
Yes.
Kathy Cox?
Yes.
Lisa Roman?
Yes. Item 6.10 is the approval of Memorandum of Understanding between Lake Havasu Unified School District Number 1 and Mojave County Department of Public Health. And it's presented by Mr. Gardner, but he's not here, so this is,
Thank you. Madam President, members of the board, it is recommended that the governing board approve the Memorandum of Understanding between Lake Havasu Unified School District and the Mojave County Department of Public Health. Approval of this MOU will allow kindergarten through eighth grade students access to nutrition education from October 1st, 2020 through September 30th, 2025. The purpose of this MOU is to provide evidence-based healthy eating and active living education in support of policy, system, and environmental change strategies to promote consumption of healthy foods and beverages and provide support for active lifestyles. Following are the links, and I know that the board had these and had an opportunity to review them. There is a separate curriculum for kindergarten, 3 through 8, that should be 1 through 5 and 3 through 5 that would be used. And this agreement has been approved by district legal counsel as to form.
The motion on item 6.10.
I move we approve the motion as read.
Second. Any discussion?
Nicole Cohen?
No.
Kathy Cox?
Yes.
Marchand Avia?
Yes.
Lisa Roman?
Yes. Item 6.11 is the approval to purchase 3 school buses, and it's presented by Mr. Murray.
Madam President, members of the board, it is recommended the governing board approve the purchase of 3 school buses through Canyon State Bus Sales at an amount not to exceed $580,000. Bond funds will be used to purchase school buses as presented to Lake Havasu Unified School District No. 1 voters prior to the November 8, 2016 election. Quotes from Canyon State Bus Sales are attached to this agenda action item for review. We'll be purchasing 284 passenger route buses and 146 passenger activity bus. You can see the total of $568,000. The pricing includes all requested options, preps, service, and parts, plus tax and delivery. We'll be utilizing the MESC contract, which is listed there, and an approved amount of $580,000 is being requested to cover any incidents. This item has been reviewed by purchasing.
Do I have an item for a motion on item 6.11?
I move we approve 6.11 as presented.
I second.
Any discussion or questions?
Is this something we do regularly? Is it something we need? What's leading to this?
This was part of the bond, the setup in the bond, and what was presented to voters. So we have the purchasing over the course of the bond sales for over 10 years. We're purchasing 3 buses per year. So that way we can have a rotation of 3 buses each year. After 10 years, we'll have 30 new school buses. Many of our school buses are well over 20 years old. So we're trying to phase that out.
So will these new buses be used to expand the routes or just replace buses that need to be retired? Okay.
They'll be replaced. Replacing and then also allowing for some spare buses as well. Should we have a bus go down, we need to have a couple spares in the fleet.
And I just wanted to make a clarification that we can't expand the route, is that correct? We're already expanded. Like, we can't offer it to our elementary schools for the most part.
Correct. We could expand high school if that were a discussion at the board level, but
where are we at with the high school? What grades? Just ninth, tenth?
It's based on just location at this point. Yeah.
I think
we have 3 buses.
We have 3 buses to the high school. Our issue has been drivers. They're one of our hardest to fill positions. So last year for probably 3 months, we had lost a driver and we had to close one of the routes. And so with expansion, we really do need to be mindful of making sure that we can fill the driver spots.
So do we have students that want to ride the bus in high school that can't because we don't have a driver?
There was a waiting list.
Yeah.
What was that?
There was a waiting list.
Can you give me an idea of how many names on the waiting list?
I don't know how many were on there. I just know we had some special requests for students that needed transportation for 504. We had to look at that list and prioritize.
I can get you an updated count as to how many are on a waiting list at this time.
I'm just curious. I mean, if it's 5, that's one thing. If it's 100, that's another.
And the numbers fluctuate too during the year. So at the beginning of the year, there tends to be greater interest. But then as kids realize that they have a friend who drives, they'd rather be in their car than the bus, then numbers fluctuate a little bit. But then that also allows for others to then now come onto the bus and have a seat on the bus. But I can get, I'll forward that to the board, the actual number that's on the waiting list.
It seems to me that was part of why we pitched the buses so hard, and I mean, the idea that now we have the buses and the money for the buses, but we don't have a bus driver doesn't seem logical to me. And we can't keep bus drivers now. It's not just speech therapists, it's bus drivers too.
Bus drivers are honestly the hardest to fill position that we have. I spend the most money advertising for bus drivers. Bus drivers, their certification is super difficult to get. And it takes a very long time to train. So by the time we hire a bus driver to the time they're driving can be 6 to 8 weeks. It's not, unless they're coming in with a bus driver license, it's not tomorrow they're ready to drive. So that is a position that there is taught that's a lead. And then we really need to make sure that we are balancing out and we're not overdriving any of the drivers to make sure that the activity drivers who tend to be retirees who just want that gig. But we worked really hard. So that's something that, you know, if we do increase, I always have every intention of filling every single position but we have to work really, really hard to find those drivers. We do have all of our positions staffed right now.
Are they full-time employees? So
drivers work five and a half hours. They do get benefits. And so typically drivers will pick up some parts here and there, but a lot of drivers do enjoy that split schedule. They'll drive in the morning and they'll drive in the afternoon. And so that's the schedule that they like.
How much does it cost for them to go through that training?
I don't know off the top of my head.
I can add that to the list before.
Thank you.
But we take care of that training. They don't pay for it themselves, correct? Or do they have to have that training before they apply?
A lot of the training occurs here on site. So Bobby and others who are certified as trainers, a lot of it has to do with just seat time behind the wheel. So that Bobby will then go out and be there in the bus with them and allow them to have their time behind the wheel. But I can get you the costs and I can forward you the actual requirements. So that way you can see it.
You and I probably on the same wavelength here, but if there is a cost and they do have to go through some kind of training, because I know that if they are heavy duty bus truck drivers that have to go through, so it's very expensive. And I know those drivers qualify, or they used to qualify to be school bus drivers. If you, what's that called? The CDL?
Yeah,
that one. The CDL. They qualify to be school bus drivers.
But then you have to do more training.
Right.
There's a bus endorsement also that will attach to the license as well.
I mean, if there is a cost, maybe we should be able to provide it, and then that would be part of your ad when you advertise.
There are lots of, it's very common for bus driver there to be teacher incentives, but also for school districts to have bus driver incentives. That's a very common thing that I see throughout the state. And that's something that we've discussed. Last month when we changed the AA for transportation to a dispatcher, that was part of my reasoning, was now the dispatcher is going to be able to drive a bus. Because the other thing that happened is if you have a bus driver go out and you have the correct number of bus drivers, we then have our maintenance supervisor driving a bus, which was happening. Bobby's driven more than I would like to admit. And so we now have another backup. So just really building a strong pool of drivers is very important. So I'm happy to continue looking for creative ways to support drivers.
And this is not unique to our district. It's actually worse down in the valley. They're having a very difficult time, and they're pulling from each other. It's pretty bad.
Any other discussion? Two new buses would be the hot topic tonight.
I had no idea that it was such a hard position to fill. You know.
We're ready to vote.
Kathy Cox?
Yes.
Regina Hellier?
Yes.
Nicole Cohen?
Yes.
Lisa Roman?
Yes.
Item 6.12 is the approval of purchase of contracted speech therapy services with Ardor Health Solutions. And this is presented by Mrs. Walter.
Madam President, excuse me, and members of the board. It is recommended that the board approve the purchase of contracted speech therapy services with Ardor Health Services for the 2021 school year with the option to renew for 1 year, not to exceed $88,000. The district has taken action to recruit qualified therapy-related services staff, but it has had difficulty filling these positions. Ardor Health Solutions is an approved vendor as part of the SAFE contract as referenced. We are requesting approval of option to contract for speech therapy services for the 2021 school year with Ardor Health Solutions at a rate not to exceed $69 an hour. The district is obligated to ensure the provision of services for eligible students to receive a free appropriate public education for students requiring related services as required under the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act. Funds from the MNO budget will be used to pay for the services. This item has been reviewed and approved for purchasing and legal counsel.
Do I have a motion on item 6.12?
I move we approve 6.12 as presented.
I second.
Any discussion or questions?
These are hard to fill positions.
They
just
are.
Like our bus drivers.
Archana Alyar?
Yes.
Nicole Cohen?
Yes.
Kathy Fox?
Yes.
Issa Roman?
Yeah. Item 6.13 is the first presentation and review of policy GCCG, GCCG-RA, GCCG-RB, GCCG-EA, GCCG-EB, and GCCG-EC, professional and support staff voluntary transfer of approved sick leave. And this is presented by Mrs. Festa-Bagel.
Madam President and Governing Board, it is recommended that the Governing Board approve the first presentation of revisions to policies GCCG, regulations GCCGRA and GCCGRB, and exhibits GCCGEA, GCCGEB, and GCCEC. It is also recommended that policies GDCG, regulation GDCGR and exhibits GDCGEA, GDCGEB, and GDCGEC be removed. Sick leave requests for the sick leave bank can be made by staff who are facing serious illnesses and have used their accrued sick leave. Staff members are able to donate days to the sick leave bank which once they have reached milestones in the number of days they have accrued. There are two major revisions to policy GCCG. The first is to combine support and certified staff together into one policy and treat them in the same manner. Policy GCCG will now be reflective of both certified and classified staff. Currently, policy states the value of sick leave bank will be based on new teacher's salary and or minimum wage, with the ability of the bank to exceed contributions, but there's lack of clarity on the value of deductions. Both certified and classified staff would be able to donate and request leave from the bank according to policy limits. The other change will allow for employees to request up to 10 days from the sick leave bank to be used to care for a family member who is ill. In order to request sick leave, they would need to be approved for FMLA leave. This would be allowed 10 days maximum throughout their employment. The other changes are updates to formatting. In 2018-19, staff received 53 days from sick leave bank. In 2019-20, staff received 210 days from the sick leave bank. Policies have been reviewed with legal.
Do I have a motion on item 6.13?
So moved.
I second.
Any discussion or questions? I did have one question. So when it says they would be allowed 10 days maximum throughout their employment, that's throughout the entire term of their, it's not capped at any specific time frame?
No, and right now we allow for none. And so this has come into place a number of ways. The most common is someone uses maternity leave. They use all their sick time and then their child gets sick. The other is with a spouse who has an illness. And so we want to keep it controlled. We don't want to keep it widespread, but we also want to honor and recognize that people sometimes take care of people. And so we would allow for 10 days of sick bank leave for that reason.
What does our experience in 2020-21 tell us so far? I mean, in terms of COVID and other.
So, I mean, right now we don't know. We're just gathering information about what's going to happen. You know, it was very different with 1920. None of this really is COVID days. These are our staff, and some of it was staff with serious illnesses who didn't return because of COVID. But last year we had an overwhelming number of staff members who had very, very serious illnesses. there was a lot of unfortunate incidents last year, and we supported a lot of staff through Sick Leave Bank. We just never know. We don't know if someone is going to get cancer and be out for an extended period of time. We work really, really close to look at, are they expected to return? We follow the policy to really make sure that we are supporting staff, but we're not letting staff abuse it. And so the committee really works together, and they look at what the reasons are, without violating HIPAA. Staff has access to COVID leave, which isn't a ton of days, but that is what their first use would be. This, if we need to, we would continue to use it.
I think this revision is overdue. I'm really happy to see it. You know, it makes me think this is the kind of benefit for our employees that when they come here and they're new here and then they have a situation and their own families and they realize that how generous the other staff members are with their own leave, and they themselves are giving up days and they might be very ill in 2 or 3 months and they don't know, but they do. And it's just a wonderful benefit. And this is one way, just like with EBT and the benefits we give with medical benefits, co-pays, deductibles, prescription meds, all that kind of thing. This is how we keep our staff. And so I commend you on this revision.
This is really personal. These are people who, you know, want to take care of themselves and want to take care of their loved ones. And so dealing with this is, it's a very human side. And so we want to make sure that it's codified in policy that this is how we're doing it, but this is how we take care of people.
Thank you. Any other discussion?
Nicole Cohen?
Yes.
Kathy Cox?
Yes.
Archie Ollier?
Yes.
Lisa Roman?
Yes.
Item 6.14, first presentation and review of policies GCBC and GCBC-E, supplementary pay plan. And this is presented by Mrs. Vesta Daigle.
It is recommended that the Governing Board approve the first presentation of revisions to policy GCBC and GCBCE supplementary pay plans extra duty pay. Following the recommendation of legal counsel, all compensation received by employees should be approved by the board. In addition to having the board approved stipend list, GCBCE, a comprehensive extra duty schedule will be brought to the board annually for approval. Staff who are eligible for stipends will be paid according to board policy or the board approved rate sheet. In addition, moving forward, extra compensation will be added to the personnel report each month. At the July meeting, the Business Services Department will ask the board to retroactively approve any extra compensation from the 1920 school year as was recommended by legal counsel. Changes have been made to GCBC regarding the extra duty schedule. Technical changes have been made to GCBCE.
Do I have a motion on item 6.14?
So moved.
I second.
Any discussion or questions?
I just have some questions as they pertain to COVID and the changes that we're talking about on our day-to-day. Because a lot of this supplemental, I'm trying to wrap my head around how we would separate our kids coming to school potentially on a day-to-day basis, but yet we're still going to allow the travel. I saw that there was overnight travel four and a bunk that was passed in the consent agenda. We're going to have kids on buses that are going to be competing as they did before. I mean, if you're playing football, you're coming into direct contact. So I'm just wondering, I'm appreciative that this is all laid out. Let me start there. I should have started there because this is the first time I've ever seen it looking like this, and that I appreciate. But this seems contradictory to the other side of things that we're looking at. So if we are going to implement anything beyond common sense policies in our district, is this going to be revisited and is this going to be altered as well? Because what I don't want is the haves and the teachers that get to take advantage of these stipends and the students that get to participate in this, their life doesn't change, but everybody else gets conditioned and their life does get changed. So I want to be real careful as we move forward that some kids aren't subject to this upside down world while others get to go on business as normal. Does that make sense?
It does. I do think that we're approving stipends, assuming that things will go on as normal.
And I'm just looking for an assurance that if they're not going to go on as normal, this is going to be revisited and it's going to be the same for all students. Not the students that participate in sports get a special pass because they are in sports, and the teachers, you know, that get these stipends are going to encourage.
I don't want to start a rumor, okay? But I am under the impression that it's not guaranteed that we will offer fall sports as we normally do. That I've heard of other districts that are looking into those types of modifications.
So I have crafted a letter and it has gone out to coaches and it needs to go out that basically says if your whatever it is doesn't happen, you won't get a stipend. So that's not exactly what you're talking about,
but it's
a little bit. So that has already started happening.
Okay.
That this is here, but we also are saying if this isn't happening, then we're not doing it. So that exists as well.
Okay.
To possibly address Mrs. Cohen's concern with the unpredictable situation, all of these positions, would there be, aren't most of these paid on a semester basis? The check comes once a semester, is that correct?
Yes. Yeah, they're all paid. Some of them are paid three times over the course,
yes.
Some are a couple.
What I'm thinking is perhaps the contract should say monthly,
mm-hmm.
and then we have to close it down so they don't end up getting a check
mm-hmm.
at the end of the semester, or all those possibilities. I mean, I actually think it's a good point that I had not thought of it.
I would like to comment, if I may, on the policy stipends. The board can bring those back at any time, so you have that. Those are the ones that the board approves that we normally have a process for, et cetera. The spreadsheet list, these are things, this is based on historical information, and so basically, because of the situation that occurred in some other school districts, we discovered that the board does not know all of the things that people get paid to do. Many of those things, as if you look through, are paid by tax credits or by booster clubs or things like that. And even though that's not money that we control, the board still needs to know that people are being paid for these things. What else we discovered was that, and I do want to clarify this now because you're going to see something different in our presentation. But when you get to in that stipend list in several pages, you'll notice that our grants information is here. So there are other, even though we've had title funds, other kinds of grant funds, the pay that people receive from those grants have never come to the board because they're described in the grant. And so what will happen now is every time someone gets paid, that will show up on a personnel report for the future. So you'll be able to see, regardless of the funding source. In fact, there's the STEM stipends that K-12 gives to our staff will be in here as well. So you'll see all of those. And that is so that you can be aware of who's being paid and for what kinds of work that they're doing. But again, this list is really historic. And so obviously, if certain things don't occur, then people aren't going to be paid for them. That's what we would anticipate as well.
And really,
and I don't know if that answered.
It does, and I appreciate it. My question really didn't have anything to do with the work in front of us. It it just seemed appropriate to ask, and I guess I didn't frame it properly, but what I was really saying was, what I don't want is elementary school kids banned from going on the new playgrounds that we just put in, and then all this still occurs, even if it's allowed. Do you see what I'm saying? Like, I want it to be either we're putting the kids together and we are letting them be as normal as possible, or not one group gets to do something where it's all together. That's all I'm saying. I hope we do nothing. I hope, I hope we do nothing special other than be careful.
It goes on as
you know, and then it goes on as normal. But if there's going to be modifications, I don't want it at the expense of any of our students, that's all. And it really didn't have to do with this policy. I'm appreciative that this is all laid out now. It's very nice to see. Thanks. We did this, Jane. Thank you.
Well, what I would like to say also, we know that we're going to be keeping Mr. Murray very busy and keep with the construction going on. So I'm not concerned about you and keeping you busy, but now that Mrs. Festa-Dagle has presented all of these complex things, what do you have any plans for the future for any other changes you're going to be presenting on the board packets? What are you working on next?
Nothing.
Well, it's amazing what these two get. You're keeping us busy, Mr. Murray, you understand?
I do have one question that I actually wrote that I didn't understand, and it was after the elementary. 10% over base stipend will be applied to the salary after the third full continuous year in the district in the same activity or sport. 20% over the base stipend will be added after the sixth substantiated continuous year in the same sport activity in the district.
So if you are a vocal music person, choir teacher, after your third year of being the choir teacher, instead of $2,000, you would make $2,200. After the sixth year, you would make $2,400. If you remember, this used to all be based off percents of base salary. And the percents, it was like whatever base salary is, and then the percents went up. So instead, since they're flat numbers, it's now just 10% of that flat number.
Okay. And I questioned that because I think I questioned that because I was happy to see in here that by May 1st, they have to either indicate that they're going to come back or the principal can say, I don't want
correct.
You, which I think is really good because it seemed that the same people got to take advantage of those stipends every year, and this will open it up. So I think that's why I was questioning it, because of the initial, but it makes sense. Thanks.
Any further discussion?
Kathy Combs?
Yes.
Archana Aliar?
Yes.
Nicole Cohen?
Yes.
Lisa Roman?
Yes. Item 6.15, this is the approval to open bank accounts associated with Northwest Arizona Employee Benefit Trust Benefits and Services. And this is presented by Mr. Murray.
Madam President, members of the board, it is recommended the governing board approve the opening of additional bank accounts with Wells Fargo in order to keep the Lake Havasu Schools Employee Benefit Trust and Northwest Arizona Employee Benefit Trust Fund separate during the transition between trusts. On February 18th, 2020, the governing board took action to dissolve the LHSEBT and accept the invitation to join the NAEBT. In order to keep the trust fund separate during this time of transition, the following bank accounts are recommended: an LHUSD number 1 NAEBT Flex account, LHUSD number 1 NAEBT HSA account, and the LHUSD number 1 NAEBT Benefits account. Establishing these accounts will allow for the future closure of bank accounts associated with the LHSEBT once the EBT fully dissolves after the payments of all incurred obligations. Account signers will be Michael Murray, Director of Business Services, and Dr. Rebecca Stone, Superintendent. This item has been reviewed by the business office.
Do we have a motion on item 6.15?
I move that we approve 6.15 as presented.
I second.
Any discussion or questions?
Would you name as many of the other groups that are in the, I mean, the NAE VT as you can think of off the top of your head?
So the NAE VT, the members within that trust are our school district, the city of Lake Havasu, the city of Kingman, and the city of Bullhead. And they're continuing to look to expand to others who are wanting to, who they would accept, who they would want them to join the NAEBT.
Thank you for your work on this, Ms. Curry.
Any other questions or discussion?
Marcia Hollier?
Yes.
Nicole Cohen?
Yes.
Kathy Cox?
Yes.
Lisa Roman?
Yes. Item 6.16 is the approval of vouchers, student activity funds, and auxiliary funds, and it's presented by Mr. Murray.
Madam President, members of the board, it's recommended the board approve vouchers for April and May of 2020, as well as the student activity funds, grades K through 12 for April of 2020, and auxiliary funds for April of 2020.
Do we have a motion on item 6.16?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion?
Nicole Cohen?
Yes.
Kathy Cox?
Yes.
Marcia Hollier?
Yes.
Lisa Roman?
Yes. That wraps up our new business. We have some informational items, and this is going to be presented by Superintendent Sayer.
Thank you. Again, I would like to highlight the gifts and donations since we do those in the consent agenda. And I mean, all of you know what was happening in our city during the months of April and May, and pretty much everything was closed down, and yet we still had generous donations, over $37,000 worth for the month of May. Our community continues to be generous, and I think I would like to take the opportunity, since we haven't had a board meeting since graduation, to thank everyone who helped out to make our virtual graduation a success, because there was a lot of time, effort that was donated, the banners that were provided for the students. Each of our elementary schools had something happen in our middle school, so there was a lot happening, even though our schools were closed, to help students to celebrate and to feel like they had completed their year, even though they weren't able to complete their year. And so I want to express my appreciation to the community, to the staff, and the administrative team for making all of that happen. I have heard from various parents, so I do want to share this. My husband and I went to the gun range, and the gentleman who works, there's an older gentleman who works in the office there, and we were talking, and he ended up sharing with me how much his granddaughter, who was, one of the officers, was concerned about graduation, and then how well it was, how much they enjoyed celebrating together as a family and being able to watch it and hear everything and see everything and actually see her speech, which they would not have been able to see from the stands. And so it was nice to hear that while people were concerned about it, once it was done, they were very appreciative of the effort. And I know that all of our staff worked very hard to have that happen. So I wanted to say that, thank you. And then I also wanted to share that it's kind of odd to be at our last full-blown regular board meeting for me. I remember my first board meeting, and I'll remember this one. It's been an amazing and fast 4 years. And I just wanted to share with you how much I appreciate the opportunity to have had here to serve the school district and the students and community. And I can't really say any more, I'll start blubbering, so thank you.
Well, I wanted to say thank you to you as well. I know we touched on this a little bit at the last meeting, but I hope that you look at yourself in the mirror and that you're proud of what you contributed to our society, and you look back on a legacy of really building education for a generation. And That's something to be very proud of, and so thank you for your steady leadership.
Thank you.
I don't know if anyone else.
I had something to say too, but I'm gonna cry too, so did you, do you have emails? Would you, I can't read the emails.
Do you want me to?
Would you mind?
Yes. Would you like that other topic emails first and then?
Oh, sure, yeah.
I'm gonna go to some other topic emails and then we'll go back to Diane, which is what I've been doing lately. So this is about masks. Okay, this is from Christina Musselman. As a primary level educator, I have a lot of concerns with students wearing masks. I fear there is more harm with them taking masks off, swapping masks, not knowing when to take them off to get air intake if breathing becomes difficult. I understand we would teach protocol, but we don't have control over what is done with those masks when they leave after the school day. I would prefer that this is an optional choice for students. Staff, out of courtesy, could survey families to see if they're comfortable with them not wearing a mask and honors those who feel that wearing a mask is necessary. Seeing the staff's mouth is crucial for many learners. Example, teaching phonics, showing the formation of the mouth, lips, teeth placement for specific letters, sounds, combinations. Colleagues shared the clear shield option. Would this requirement be flexible for staff and students to pursue additional options? If required, would the school district be resupplying masks, or families have the option to purchase a mask at school similar to t-shirts? Next is from Stephanie Luaris, is from Marcia Cox, who says that she wholeheartedly endorses the appointment of Ms. Luaris. Back to Diana. This is from Marcia Cox. Dear Diana, my, how quickly the years have come and gone since I had the pleasure of meeting you. Seems like only yesterday I was preparing for my first meeting with you, and I was wondering what in the world I could ever offer you in service to help take our school district to a place of healing, transparency, and virtue. You see, after meeting you the first time, I knew all of these things would be a part of your time as a superintendent of LHUSD. Little did I know how much I would learn along the way by listening and watching you in action. Your deeds, insight, and plans for our children's future and recognition for our community's needs are leaving our LHUSD a better place. I'm grateful for the laughs and tears we have shared, for our schools and community, and that you are always open for discussion, even on the hard subjects. I'm forever grateful for your commitment and changes you made in bringing Rachel's Challenge to our schools, and your vision in bringing the Hillsdale Varney Charter School program to Oro Grande. I know you see each of our children as an individual gift from God, and you should enjoy the excitement education brings. You've made LHUSD a better place, and although I'm sorry to see you leave the district, I am so very happy that you will remain a part of it as a retiree with only a wonderful life and adventure ahead for you and Fred. God bless you and keep you with gratitude. Marcia Cox, Chairperson, the Cavasu Unified Employee Benefit Trust. From Mike File. I want to congratulate Mrs. Assayer for all she's done for the district. It was an extreme pleasure working with her. May your retirement be adventurous and exciting. I also welcome Mrs. Stone to the district. It is very rare that you see an outgoing and incoming administrator work together, and it has been impressive, not just to me, but to the other Mojave County school administrators, to see them both working together to ensure there is a seamless transition for students in Lake Havasu. Best wishes to you both, Mike File, Mojave County School Superintendent. The last one is from Superintendent Diane Douglas.
That's so nice to hear somebody else do that in this room.
Dear Diana, I appreciate this opportunity to not only congratulate you on your upcoming retirement, but also your incredible record of service to students, parents, and citizens of Lake Havasu City Unified School District. I've known and worked with many superintendents over my years of service as the parent of a child in public schools, as a governing board member and president,
in Peoria Unified School District and most recently as Arizona Superintendent of Public Instruction. Never before have I had the privilege of knowing and working with a leader who lives and personifies putting the children and community first as you do. You have offered the children of LHUSD an unprecedented opportunity by offering the Hillsdale Barney Charter School Program at Oregon Day Classical Academy. I only wish all of the children of Arizona could be offered this true classical education experience. From my time on the PUSD Governing Board, I know the challenges of providing employee benefits while protecting the taxpayer dollars. Your work and oversight you have brought to the Lake Havasu Employee Benefit Trust will ensure both for years to come. I pray that God will grant you and Fred his blessings, strength, and peace, whatever the next phase of your life leads you. Thank you for your service to the children and families of Lake Havasu Unified School District. Warmest regards, Diane Douglas. Those are all.
I'm glad someone mentioned Mr. Osiris because I feel like he deserves like an honorary superintendent retirement.
Here, here.
Amazing to see him at every meeting. So.
All right, mine's really short because I'm going to try not to cry. So, dear Diana, thank you seems so insufficient, but it must be said. Specifically, thank you for your scholarship. It's obvious to everyone who knows you. For your character, because it's esteemed and respected in our community. For your humanity, it's worthy of imitation by young and old. For your application of the virtues in your daily life. Your compassion, your perseverance, your responsibility, your respect, temperance, integrity, diligence, and courage, your leadership in understanding the universals, and your steady care of the particulars. Your humility, which makes you the best kind of teacher, and that is honorable. Your willingness to pursue truth and defend liberty. I could not be more honored to call you my friend and my teacher. Thank you. And, all right then. So in honor of the best superintendent ever, no pressure, Dr. Stone. I'd like to make a donation of my own to the superintendent's office. So I have an 1828 dictionary so that you can understand the Western and American Heritage Hillsdale readers. And then I also have a framed copy of the Declaration and the Constitution, because I think all of those are really relevant right now. And I can't think of a better reason to have them apply it in Diana's honor for all her work to truly educate our students. So that's it. Yeah. And then I'll have a little private ceremony with Diana after it's all over. Thank you so much. You made it so much easier to be here fighting over the last 4 years. So, very grateful.
I would just like to thank the board for giving me the opportunity to actually come here and work with Diana for quite a while. I've learned so much from her, and definitely everything that I've heard in the emails and heard from Mrs. Cohen is absolutely the truth, and I can only hope to make you proud of this position. I would like to congratulate and thank you, not only for your contribution to the school district and the city and everything, but also to me personally,
It's been my first year on the board, and I have learned so much from you. And also congratulate you for dealing with these trying times in such a superb manner. I have heard only good things, of course, about everyone and how we managed the whole last few months. And while Dr. Stone has big shoes to fill, I'm sure that she is going to do all of us proud, and we look forward to working with you and wish you and your family and your friends a wonderful retirement.
Actually, she helped us handle all of those questions. I got to go last. I want to be her. You know me, I'm going to have more to say than she did. Just me. So I asked Anna, how many boards have you had during your tenure here? And I believe she said 4 boards. And they have been rather contentious boards. The members have not always gotten along. More often than not, I think they have not gotten along. And it could not have been fun stepping into something like that. And then we had the situation with the EBT, and information was very difficult to believe, and a shock to the staff. It was just a bomb. But you stepped into it. And that was ending up just as I was coming on. But regardless, you've just weathered every bomb as it's come along, and then it's kind of gone away. So I keep saying, how has she done this? You know, you're still here. Nicole, you're still here. You haven't gone anywhere. Terry, you're still here, you know. How have you managed to do this? And I think it has to be your personal characteristics. You're very unique in your personal character, in your character. And you listen to people, and then you also, unlike other administrators that I'm used to, you disagree right there on the spot. And I know where you stand, and that's okay. And then even when I disagree right back at you, we meet again another day. So I really appreciated that quality in you. You do your research, and you don't mind getting down in the weeds of the data, and that research is what helps you decide. It's not just something intuitive. You actually do the research, and I respect that a lot. You are an excellent communicator, both in your oral and written communication. Almost every school board meeting I've been at, somebody had a question. And it could be something that happened 3 board meetings ago. You know, I'm not going to remember. I'm not going to be able to answer. I've just been amazed every time. Somehow or other, that memory of yours, you just go right back to the facts. And you just start spouting them off. That's a gift, okay? I want you to know that's a gift. I don't know what this is. I can't read my own handwriting as usual. I have to say this, so just wait. Oh, this is important. I have not heard one person say anything negative about your character. Now, I have heard people disagree with you, like with Singapore math, you know, when the classical, but that goes with the territory. But no one has said anything about your character, that you're devious, that you're looking out just for yourself, or your name, you make a big name for a big splash for yourself. Nobody. That's very unusual, especially when it comes to school superintendents. And this is right here. I've heard principals say only good things about you. That is just remarkable. Principals only have said good things about you, and that's quite a tribute to you. And you've been here since I've been, you know, EBT that brought the Singapore math on. I told you I have some concerns about it. But it looks like we've weathered the storm. I haven't heard from everybody yet, but I won't let you know what, you know, it sounds like we're moving on. We're moving along fine. The Classical Academy, that's just gone over really well. The things, you know, the override failed, and we had to deal with it. And then we had a new override, and you were involved with getting that passed.
and that just changed everything, plus the legislature and the governor providing financial support. So, recently getting counselors for elementary, all of those things take work. So, I'm sorry. I mean, I wish I had had more time with you, but it's been my honor, and I've learned a lot from you. I still don't agree with you everything, but we know where we stand, don't we? And it's I would say it's integrity. I admire that very much. We're going to miss you, but now we're handing you over to Fred. And from what I hear, you two are really looking forward to spend some time together, because I don't think he's seen a lot of you in the last several years.
It's been a 30-year vacation. It's over.
So, ciao, arrivederci, or bon voyage. I don't have any champagne, but something celebratory. You deserve it, but we just can't do that during this the COVID virus.
We have an opening on our employee benefit trust board. Nothing to do.
You haven't already fulfilled your lifetime quota of meetings.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Thank you all. I appreciate those words, and I appreciate the words of the last meeting as well, Mrs. Roman. I have to say that this has been the most amazing team I've ever worked with, and that means. And having to use words for the board, but the board team, the part of it that I had so much joy out of it is that everybody who has come and served on our board has been here because they want to do what's best for kids from their heart. And while we disagree, that doesn't erase the intention, as you mentioned, of wanting to do what's right for people. And that there hasn't been a groupthink, and it's very dangerous to have groupthink. And so all of the opinions have been expressed, sometimes a little bit more dramatically than others, but everybody's opinions have been expressed to the good of the district. And those are qualities that I so admire about my Havasu. And I have learned so much over the last 4 years. And I've learned from my teammates, the things that we've talked about accomplishing were not met by me, they were done by us. And it's just been a joy.
Thank you.
Any other information items? Any other emails that came in through call the public? No. Okay. I think that's
it. I have one more thing. Just hitching on something Diana said about graduation. I think it would be appropriate if I mentioned that we do recognize and appreciate the parents of the seniors who put the dance on. The district could not really, for a variety of reasons, we could not get involved with that, but the parents put it together, and I'm sure it was a lot of work, but it seemed to have been successful and the students enjoyed it. So I just want to let them know that we appreciate what they did for their seniors.
I will entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second. Kathy Cox?
Yes.
Nicole Cohen?
Yes.
Tatiana Hollier?
Yes.
Lisa Roman?
Yes.
Thank you.
Meeting's adjourned.
Thank you.